town hall tonight. In a few minutes, you'll hear from Congressman Edwards about issues he's working on here in Washington and ways his office is working hard to serve all of Western North Carolina. The Congressman is going to speak for just a couple of minutes to kick us off, but it's important to note that tonight's event is a two-way conversation, and we want you to be involved in the conversation. If you have a question for Congressman Edwards, press *3 anytime. That's *3. And we'll take as many questions as we can tonight. We're eager to get your opinions and hear any feedback you have. We won't be able to get to every single question, unfortunately, but we're going to take as many as we possibly can. And if we don't get to your question, please contact our office and we'll get you a response. Or we'll make sure to try to get you on the next telephone town hall event in January. You can keep up with Representative Edwards on Facebook, on Twitter, or on Instagram at Rep Chuck Edwards. That's R-E-P Chuck Edwards. Or visit our website, sign up for updates at edwards.house.gov. And without further ado, here is Congressman Edwards.
Well, good evening, everyone. It's great to be here with you tonight. I'm sorry we're running a bit behind. Votes took quite a bit longer than what we would have expected on a Monday night. I appreciate every one of you tuning in tonight, and I want you to know I always enjoy updating my friends in Western North Carolina on the work that's going on up here in Washington, D.C. on your behalf. I'm also excited to share with you tonight that my bill, H.R. 5473, the Promoting Resilient Buildings Act, passed the House with a unanimous vote. This is my first bill presenting on the House floor. It's not the bill I would have preferred would have been my first one, but it's an important bill nonetheless. It reduces regulation, something that all of you know is extremely important to me as a businessman, and my history in the North Carolina Senate shows that I certainly support our small businesses as well. And this bill helps bring down home costs and brings consistency to the home building community. We've got a really busy week here this week, headed into Christmas. One of the most significant votes is that we'll deal with the bill to formalize impeachment inquiry against President Biden, something that I know most of the folks back at home have been waiting on. I'm also pleased to share that there will be no end-of-the-year omnibills this year that will allow Senate Democrats and President Biden to push for even more spending. This is one of the things that I think that the new Speaker Johnson most significantly brought to the House, because all of you know from watching the way things have worked here in D.C. over the years that Christmas really becomes the witching hour in D.C. Folks come down to the end of the session, they want to go home for Christmas, and they vote on stuff that they really shouldn't be voting on. We're avoiding that this year. Again, thank you all for joining us tonight, and I'm really looking forward to your questions and hearing what's on your mind. So with that, Ray, who are we going to speak with first?
Thank you, Congressman. One more note, if you've just joined us, it's *3 to ask a question for Congressman Edwards live on this telephone town hall. It's *3. And I'm going to start with, before we get to our first question, which is from Alexandra in Brevard, I'm going to let everyone know that from January 5th through March 5th, if you're not on our office's subscriber list, you won't be able to receive updates about issues and legislation that affects folks in North Carolina's 11th congressional district because of election laws. So just to make sure that you receive communication from the congressman from January through March of next year, if you could just press 1, then that will opt you in to receive communications from Congressman Edwards' office. You can just push 1 on your mobile phone if you're interested in getting updates from the congressman's office. Okay, so we'll go to Alexandra from Brevard, who has a question about funding for the Israel-Palestine conflict.
All right. Alexander, how are you tonight?
I'm doing well. Thank you for taking my question.
Yeah, certainly. What is it?
Yes. As of today, over 18,000 Palestinians have been murdered by the Israeli military since October 7th. Over 7,792 of those were children. Thousands more are missing under the rubble. After the tragic events of October 7th, in which Hamas forces murdered 1,200 Israelis, you said Israel was being invaded by, and I quote, ruthless murderers who have no regard for human life. If you say in murdering 1,200 Israelis, which to be sure is a horrible tragedy, Hamas fighters show no regard for human life, what do you call the mass civilian casualties happening in Palestine as we speak? Surely you hold the Israeli government, which is largely funded by taxes taken from the pockets of hardworking Americans, to the same standard. Does every civilian casualty count as a tragic loss, or only Israeli ones? I'd like you to justify your unwavering support for Israel when time and time again it shows an appalling lack of regard for human life. Does it have anything to do with the $10,000 your campaign has received from the American Israel Public Affairs Committee? You call yourself a fiscal conservative, and yet how do you justify sending $14.3 billion to Israel in the wake of October 7th? On top of that, $0.8 billion the U.S. already sends annually to Netanyahu and his government. How high does the stack of children's bodies have to be for you to do something? Why does genocide warrant billions of taxpayer dollars in funding, yet you've done nothing to help your constituents in Western North Carolina as the cost of living continues to skyrocket, and your people are struggling to make ends meet? I'd like you to explain yourself.
Yeah, well, Alexandra, obviously we have a bit of a difference in some of the allegations that you made. You made some pretty harsh allegations. I would say to you that Israel has been one of America's strongest allies in the Middle East for decades, and I believe most Americans would choose to stand behind Israel. I would also agree with you that every loss of life is unfortunate. And it is extremely unfortunate that in the Middle East, there is a war going on right now that was started by Hamas, where Hamas are using many of the casualties that you referenced as human shields to protect themselves against from Israeli soldiers. Israel certainly has the right to exist. I'll continue to stand for their right to exist. And it has absolutely nothing to do with any contribution made from in anyone. But I do appreciate you sharing your concern. Ray, who's next?
Okay, Congressman, our next question comes from Roxanne, who's in Waynesville.
Hello, Roxanne in Waynesville. How are you?
Good.
What is your question? What's on your mind tonight?
My question is that I'm just wondering if you think it will ever align for all of us that have worked here forever, our whole lives in the United States, and our Social Security doesn't relate to what we've done, but that's all we have to rely on once we retire. And yet people are coming into the country getting thousands of dollars and all kinds of help for free. And I don't understand that.
Well, I wish I could certainly justify that, Roxanne, and I can't. Unfortunately, we have an administration right now, right over here on Pennsylvania Avenue, that seems to have no regard whatsoever for how hard you and others like you have worked all of your life. And they're allowing an invasion to continue at the border where folks can come in and claim asylum and continue to collect American tax dollars, maybe for 7 to 10 years while they're waiting on a court date. So I wish I could justify it. I cannot. I can tell you that the U.S. House is doing everything that we can at this time to secure the border. You know, we passed H.R. 2 earlier this year. that would have put the reforms in place and began building the wall to keep people out. It would have reinstituted President Trump's remain in Mexico policies. It would have revamped the asylum process. It would have deployed more border agents to the southern border. And that bill was the most significant bill in America's history at protecting our borders. Now we have coupled the same components in that bill with the president's request that we send funding to Ukraine, because most of us believe, and most of the people I'm hearing from in Western North Carolina are saying, that while we do not want to see Putin running across Europe, we also have to pay attention to our own borders. And I think we have to insist that those components of HR 2 be a part of any supplemental funding to help out Ukraine. Thank you. Thank you for that question. Ray?
Who's next? Next, we have Dave from Hendersonville, who has a question about anti-Semitism on college campuses.
Hey, Dave in Hendersonville. How are you tonight?
I'm good. Thanks, Chuck. Appreciate you taking my call and being on the radio and keeping us informed. And I so appreciate your sponsorship of this bill to control apportionment of congressional districts based on citizens and not population. I think I read about that recently, and I fully support you on that. Also, I am concerned about the anti-Semitic activity on our college campuses, many of which receive federal dollars, and I think they should be cut off if they continue to allow this sort of behavior and threatening of Jews.
Dave, I could not agree with you more. In fact, we had a potential protest bubbling up over at UNCA here just a few weeks ago, and I put public pressure on the administration and the board of trustees there to put the kibosh on that, because we certainly don't need to see that anti-Semitism, not only anywhere, but particularly right here in our district, right here in our mountains. And I know that we have a lot of folks here in Congress right now looking at how we can prevent any university that's public funded with by using those funds and using those campuses to be, quite frankly, racially charged. And anti-Semitism is a racially charged subject. And by many other definitions, that would be called out and criticized right away. So thank you for that. I agree with you, and we're certainly putting the fight to the anti-Semitism here in Washington, D.C. So thank you.
Congressman, our next question is from Michael, who has a question about Jewish persecution and agriculture.
All right, Michael, how are you tonight? Where do you live?
I live in Hiawatha Dam.
Oh, you're
thank
way
you
out
Thank you for your time.
Yeah. Well, thank you for being with us tonight. What's your question?
Well, one of the things is with agriculture part is, we just need to make sure that we do all we can to support more programs with ag, because due to the crisis at the border, we haven't inherited 7 to 8 million more mouths to feed in the upcoming year. So I think we should always be looking at ways to better feed the people in Western North Carolina and the people all over our state and the United States. And that's just a lot of burdens put on us to produce enough food to do that. So we should always be looking for programs to make sure we can provide the food to feed the world.
Yeah. Michael, you sound like a farmer. What do you farm? Are you a farmer? I think I lost Michael. But what I can say, Michael, is I agree with you. We need to be supporting our agriculture community for lots of reasons. one of which is that Americans really enjoy being fed. We've had a little bit of a hiccup with the farm bill here in Washington, D.C., and we know that our farmers are out there depending on the security of that farm bill in order to borrow the money that they need to get crops in the ground in the spring. And so we've pushed that farm bill back until September while we can work out the details and hopefully get more agreement on how we're going to support agriculture here from Washington, D.C. So thank you for that comment. I appreciate it.
Congressman, we have a question next from Fred from Hendersonville about constituent services, but I want to pause just really quickly and ask a one question survey of everyone who's live on the call tonight. And the question is this: do you feel that in general you've been paying higher prices over the past few years? Have you been paying higher prices over the past few years? If your answer is yes, you just press 1 on your keypad. And if your answer is no, press 2. So have you been paying higher prices? 1 for yes, 2 for no. Congressman, now you're on with Fred from Hendersonville.
Hey, Fred in Hendersonville.
Hello, Chuck. A couple of things I want to do. First thing I want to do is tell you how much I appreciate you remembering the constituents that you care about, that you are representing, and doing all I think that anybody could figure out how to do to wait on us. And I appreciate it very much. The other issue or two or three that I'm concerned about is certainly the border. That border is no different than everybody that's listening. To at least leave the front door open and let whoever wants to come in. As long as you don't have any bad people around, I guess it'd be okay. It wouldn't be too good on the cold. Other issue is our higher learning institutions have been bought out. We've now seen in the last few days by other countries. And sold out our country in some ways against our allies and seem to forget the very important issues that happened to Israel. It's unbelievable to me how you can be confused on that front. And there's one more thing that I care about and appreciate, and that's it's just lost me. So I'll say this. I am a farmer, and I care about other farmers and the people in this area, too. We're working hard now to try to figure ways to keep farmers farming, keep their land so they can farm, and also we're trying to facilitate the markets and interests that the farmer needs. He has to have a place to sell whatever he grows or his goods. And this area, I think, is working very hard at those two issues. Thank you very much.
Fred, you've left a lot there for me to unpack. Let me see where I can get started. First of all, I appreciate you recognizing how me and my team have prioritized constituent services. And quite frankly, that's one of the things we all enjoy most about serving in Congress, having the ability to get that out there among the people, to hear what's on their minds, to help with casework. I was ringing the bell for the Salvation Army this weekend and had a chance to take in a couple pieces of casework, folks that came by, recognized me, and had something that they wanted to talk about. Most of you are aware of that we have the only mobile congressional office in the entire United States, which has given us the opportunity to get out and do about 300 visits since March, 300 office visits in and around Western North Carolina. With it being such a vast district, that has worked out great for us. You talked about the southern border. that is probably the thing that is on most Americans' minds right now, just how porous our border is and how President Biden seems to be turning his back to it. Even in spite of the fact that we're seeing mayors and governors from Democrat governments starting to push back and say, "Uncle, we just can't take anymore. We have to do something about this." And I referenced earlier what the House is attempting to do now by combining our border protections with Ukraine funding. You said that it's okay to leave your door open if there's no bad people that come by, but we all know there are a lot of bad people out there right now trying to get into this country. We're even hearing from the FBI now that there could be, of all things, a terrorist threat because of all these folks coming across the border. So you've left us an awful lot to talk about. In addition, you're talking about preserving our farmland. I couldn't agree with you more. We've got a couple of bills up here that we've been working on that would prevent China from purchasing farmland. So there's obviously a lot on your mind, and you have every reason to be concerned. But please know that I hear you loud and clear, and we're doing everything that we can in spite of this divided government. We've got Schumer over in the Senate that is pushing back on many of the things that you just referenced. And, of course, we know what we've got in the White House right now. So, Brad, thank you for calling in. I appreciate it. Ray, what have we got next?
Congressman, next we have Paul from Waynesville who has a question about deficit spending.
Okay, Paul, you've got a lot to talk about there too, from Waynesville. What's on your mind?
Good evening, Congressman, and thank you for holding this town hall. Thank you for making the sacrifices in your personal life to serve the people of Western North Carolina in our United States Congress. You and I have actually met in connection with a real estate transaction probably 17 years ago or so. I know you're a successful businessman. I know you could probably be doing anything you want, but you're serving us in Congress, and thank you for that. I also know that as a successful businessman, you see the problem that is building with deficit spending in our federal government. Nobody could run a business like this. If you would run your business like this, you'd be out of business. Now, I know that on this topic, I'm kind of preaching to the choir. But what I'm asking you is, do you have any ideas regarding how we can make more of our fellow citizens aware and sensitive to this problem?
Paul, is it my turn?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, hey, I do appreciate you calling in, and you're absolutely right. Our deficit is one of the top items that is a national security threat because we're at $33.6 trillion in debt right now. That's clicking up every day. We now spend more money every year on servicing the interest on that debt than we do on our national defense. And I'm really excited to be part of the House Budget Committee. New members typically do not get appointed to the Budget Committee, but with my history, my service in the North Carolina Senate, and as being a businessman, I was able to land a position on that committee. Paul, and all of the others out there, what I've recognized while working here in Washington, D.C., is the system is broken that we use to appropriate funds. There's always the ability for us to say no to particular spending measures, and we all know that there's not a good political will out there right now, but even for those folks that have that political will, the system in which we have to exercise it is broken. I equate it as to trying to fly an airplane while you're building it. We come in on these 2-year terms. We've got a history of waiting on the president first to introduce his budget, which usually doesn't come until May or June, and then we spend months disproving that it worked or that it's the right budget. And then we have to bring the committee process forward and pass what we would hope would be 12 individual spending bills, which normally takes weeks, before the end of the fiscal year, which is the end of September. And then we're under the threat of government shutdowns. We typically end up having to pass a continuing resolution to get past that. And then it starts all over again. So I'm really excited that the budget chairman Arrington from Texas appointed me to a budget oversight task force where I intend to help change the process because it's broken. Unfortunately, we're still here about halfway through this congressional term trying to put forth our 12 spending bills in the middle of a broken process. That's going to take a while. Also, Paul, you need to know that the budget committee, of which I'm a part, since last February had been working on a budget resolution, and we passed that just a couple of months ago to show the Americans what it would take for us to get ourselves back on track and be able to balance our budget in the next 10 years. We put forth a budget resolution that would roll back spending by $16 trillion and get us to the point that we could balance our budget in 10 years. I couldn't agree with you more. It's a terrible problem, but we have a very tough structure that we have to operate in to get it fixed. But I believe we can do it. Thank you for sharing that concern. Ray, what do we have next?
Congressman, we've got a question from Margaret, who is from Marshall, and she'd like to know about your vote on Representative Kalima.
Are you talking about the censure of Tlaib, the vote that I took to censure Tlaib? I don't hear Margaret, but also,
Margaret, are you there?
Margaret, well, for all of you out there listening, and Margaret, thanks for the question. The way that I equate this is that there are often more roads to get to the same location. We may choose to take a path to the left. We may choose to take a path to the right. I believe most of the people in Western North Carolina wanted to see Rashida Tlaib censured. I certainly wanted to see her censured. Her statements were racist. They were offensive. And I chose one path over the other to get to the same exact point that most people in Western North Carolina wanted to see, and that was to see her censured. So I was very, very proud to cast that vote for her censure. And we ended up doing what I think folks in Western North Carolina wanted us to do. So thank you for that. Ray, who's up next?
Next is Tony from Brevard, who has a question about election integrity.
Hey, Tony in Brevard. You're concerned about elections.
Actually, it's Tory.
Oh, I'm sorry. Tory.
That's all right. First, I want to commend you on your support for Israel and the prevention of the genocide of the Jews. I mean, that's just critical, and I appreciate you standing up for that at a time when it's not necessarily popular. But I know there's a lot of important things on the agenda, and you probably go in 10 million different directions. But what about elections? And I noticed you're on that caucus. I mean, what can you tell me that's going to help me believe that what's going to happen next November is going to be the correct.
And that's a great question. It certainly is a concern on so many Americans' minds. First of all, I can tell you that North Carolina, thanks to the good work that three legislative sessions conducted while I was in the state Senate, North Carolina has some of the highest election integrity in the entire nation. In fact, I took some of what we did in North Carolina up here to Washington, D.C. We passed the ACE Act. Can't remember exactly what the words mean for ACE. Oh, yeah, it's the American Confidence in Elections Act. And, Tori, what that does is puts in place what I'm going to call some incentives for the states, because you know our Constitution requires that elections are, the time, manner, and place of elections are determined by state legislators. Congress has no direct authority, but what Congress can do is lay out the framework of what that authority by the states might look like. And the ACE Act does some significant things. It requires that states do not receive federal funding for elections if they allow non-citizens to vote. It gives states access to federal databases, like the Social Security death list, for example, so that states can keep their own voter rolls maintained. It allows states to use the Real ID as proof of citizenship. It prohibits federal funds from going to states that allow third-party money like Zuckerberg to come in. And I personally wrote one of the provisions in that bill, which is to prevent ballot harvesting. And this was based off of some of the fraudulent activity that we've seen in North Carolina and the fixes that we put in place for that. So I personally wrote the provision that would, I called it No Federal Funds for the Ballot Harvesting Act, that prevents any federal funds from going to states that permit ballot harvesting. And I think that most Americans would agree is the biggest vulnerability to our elections. Now, there's no question that folks are going to continue to look for ways to cheat, but I believe that this Congress, certainly my service in this Congress, is geared towards fixing the things that we can at a national level so that we can ensure fair and accurate elections. Thank you for that. Thank you for your concern. Ray, who's next?
Congressman, we have time for one or maybe two more questions, and we'll start with Robert from Hendersonville, who has a question about FISA.
Okay, Robert, how's it going?
Very well, sir. And
it is. Well, I'm doing great, but our country's falling apart. We're up here
together. Yes, I've been watching. I was just wondering, do you, if we don't do anything on 702, does it just roll over and stay the same, or is there some measure of control we can interject in this without losing the valuable commodity we have in having, especially in these crazy times, the ability to seek potential bad actors?
Robert, it is your question is timely because I spent about 2 hours with some of my House colleagues earlier this afternoon debating this very issue. So the answer to your question is if we do nothing, FISA 702 expires at the end of this year. and we would not have the ability to monitor terrorists like we do today. And so what I think you're going to see is an act this week to extend FISA over into next year, probably about April, while we drop back and try to put together a better plan than what we've got right now. Because it's clear that while lives have been saved, American lives have been saved. And all of you, I'd like to know, for you to know that I'm privy to a top secret classification. And so I have the ability to get top secret briefings on how FISA is used and some of the things that it has prevented that I can't share with you, but I can assure you that it being in place has saved American lives. Now, I can also assure you that the FBI has been misusing FISA. There's documented evidence. They have admitted to us that it has been misused, we believe, 278,000 times. There have been some reforms put in place that have brought that down to 691 times since those reforms have been put in place, but it's still being misused. And there's a huge debate right now on how we reform it and what the consequences should be of any member of the FBI that misuses it. You might not recognize that. I mean, I didn't realize it. There are 10,000, about 10,000 FBI agents that have access to that FISA database. We intend to bring that down to about 900. And then we also intend to put together an accountability process where anyone that were to misuse it could maybe spend 10 years in prison. And there's several other provisions in terms of how and when it might be able to be used if an American were suspected of some terrorist activity or coordinating with terrorists. So the answer to your question is if we do nothing, it goes away December 31st, and that would not be a good thing. But thank you for that question. Ray, let's take one more.
Congressman Don from Murphy has our final question, and it's about funding for Mexico and drug cartels making their way across the southern border.
Well, Don and Murphy, you're a whole lot closer to Mexico than the most of the rest of us, so this is another timely question. What's on your mind?
So I hardly know where to start. I am military veteran number one, retired North Carolina law enforcement officer number two, and I'm 72 years old. I have never seen this country. Excuse me. I'm sorry. I thought I could hold it together. I'm just so upset in our country. I should say Congress cannot stop this insanity of people coming across our border and designate cartels as foreign terrorist organizations and deploy military assets against them, shut our borders down as a matter of national security, and penalize any country that allows any immigration into this country illegally through Mexico. And I know pretty much why it's not being done, but we need to start using the word treason every single time we discuss this subject. It is the only thing to get the public's awareness. I'm just born wars. We think more of the countries like Ukraine than we do our own country. What is wrong with this?
Well, obviously, obviously, Don, there's a lot of things that is wrong with it. The biggest thing that's wrong is that President Biden does not have the political will to tackle this problem. And there's so many folks want to say we need to send more money to the southern border, and we certainly recognize some ways that we can do that. But the reality is there are laws in place already. There are mechanics in place already that would allow our border to be shut down were the political will there. I certainly hear the passion in your voice, and my heart goes out to you and every other American that sees how we're being invaded and the lack of political will by the current and administration. But I want you to know that I hear you loud and clear. I know that folks want accountability. Americans want accountability, particularly in Western North Carolina. You might have recognized that there was a vote to there was a vote against Mayorkas here just a few weeks ago. Unfortunately, that failed. But we're taking every action we can. I think that we're down to an inflection point right now with so many people wanting us to do something about Ukraine that we're going to be able to leverage that point to get something done. We've even now got the Senate on board with us. It's tough sometimes for the House and the Senate to work together, but it seems that we've got many folks over in the Senate now that are on board with us. So I'm hopeful, I'm optimistic, and we all certainly recognize that we simply have to close our southern border. So thank you for your service to our country, and thank you for your passion around this.
Thank you, Congressman, and thank you to everyone who has joined us tonight on this live interactive town hall. It's really important that you have access to your representative in Washington, that you hear directly from Congressman Edwards, and that you have a chance to give feedback and be an active voice for your community. And before we say goodnight, I want to turn things over to Congressman Edwards for one final remark.
Hey, I know that there are a lot of things all of you could be doing out there tonight. You could be wrapping your Christmas presents, spending time with your families. I appreciate that you've taken time to join me, allow me to answer a few questions, and certainly to hear what's on your mind. You have no idea how much I learn about you and what's on your mind just through your questions. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. I'm very grateful for that. Just like to say also, God bless America, and I wish each and every one of you a very, very Merry Christmas.
And again, if we didn't get to your question tonight, please go to edwards.house.gov. You can contact our office there and sign up for updates from Congressman Edwards. Thank you all. Have a great night. God bless.
The Access Live event has ended. Thank you for calling. Goodbye.
Thanks for watching. Be sure to subscribe to AnnieDance.substack.com if you haven't already.